Our last speaker before we get to Fast Global, which we've been waiting for all day, is Dr. Robert Carson. And he's going to be talking to us about a real significant issue in our community that everyone is waiting to try to understand and relying on you to explain it, which I know is going to be challenging. Which is really trying to understand dystonia and Angelman syndrome. So from Vanderbilt University, Dr. Carson. Do you want a handheld or you good?
Yeah, I'll stay in the thing.
Well, hello, everybody. I'm Rob Carson. So over the next hour, I'm just making sure you're awake. I know it's late in the day. Oh, that's right. Right, somebody's likes to stay on time. So I'll do my best to not make anybody mad at me. So, of course, I gotta figure out how to use the clicker. There we go. So I think key things, I'm involved in some of the same clinical trials that many others here are. And the work we're gonna talk about today has been sponsored by the Angelman Syndrome Foundation. So I think everyone in this room is aware there's a lot of different movements that we see in Angelman Syndrome. And some of them, like stereotypies, are just the funny things our kids do, not harmful. There's other things that are more disruptive, including seizures. And non-epileptic myoclonus is kind of what really moved me into this world of abnormal movements in Angelman Syndrome. So this was the study approach that we took, which this was all around the time of COVID where there wasn't a lot of travel, so everything was survey-based. And I kind of just, I'm showing how it kind of worked through of people who started surveys, people who went through the consent, completed surveys, and then we had a combination of the actual submitted survey data as well as videos. And so the whole goal was to have this combination of both and put them all together to figure out what people are seeing at home and then figure out what these movements are. So one of the challenges when I was working through the data is just pointing out here that about a third of the submissions reported three or more abnormal movements. And so that just made it extra challenging trying to fish out what, even within this data, what kind of movements are we talking about, what medicines worked, what didn't work. And so when we took the subset of patients that had videos, the next step was I sat down with a group of 10 movement disorders experts, showed them a video and said, what is this? And then we discussed, and so we kind of, you know, didn't necessarily come to a consensus. But of the people, if you look at the whole group, 19% had movements consistent with dystonia. If we look at just those that had video submissions, it was 45%. And so I thought this was really interesting because, well, this isn't something we really talk about much. Of course, there's lots of us doing lots of research. And in 21, this paper came out. So while I'm saying, wow, 45%, this paper in a cohort of adults reported that 93% had movements consistent with dystonia. And so we can all ask, well, geez, how did we not know this? Well, and part of it is, as they point out, in their cohort, a lot of it was mild. Often there's other issues, so some mild, you know, movements that aren't overly disruptive, we just kind of don't worry about too much. And I think one of the challenges is a lot of these kind of movements get worse with age. So there's a lot of us that are pediatric neurologists. And so there's things that just don't show up in the younger children. And even in our survey data, a lot of the movement disorders started in the teenage years. So based on their paper, you could say, well, if this is mild, yeah, why do we even care? And one, I think it suggests mechanisms and what part of the brain is involved and what is making the movements. In many movement disorders, things are very simple and straightforward, and somebody has a distinct tremor, and that's all they have. I think in Angelman syndrome, these movements are more complex, and I think I'll try to reinforce that when we talk about some of these things. to me, what's really important is when we looked in the survey data of what medicines people had used to treat abnormal movements, of the more routine medicines used to treat things like dystonia, for example, Sinemet, carbidopa, levodopa is one. One of 47 patients had ever tried it. Ropinirole, which is another movement disorder drug, nobody reported. And then one medicine called trihexyphenidyl or Artane, which some of us have talked about before, 8 out of 47. And I put an asterisk by that because some people describe multiple movements, so that could be overestimating. So the whole point is there's classes of medicines that are available, but that we just haven't been using. So if you get a bunch of movement disorders people together, you'll find out they argue over just what to call things, which makes it much more fun to figure out. And so I'm to show videos of things, I promise. So it'll make more sense, but dystonia is often kind of this odd posturing. And as part of that posturing, people can have tremulous movements. Again, the movement disorders purists would say, well, that's not a tremor by definition, but we'll just ignore what they think. But what's important in this case is the treatment of dystonic tremor is the same as the treatments for dystonia. So whether we can debate what name to call it, we could treat it the same way. So a key thing I want to point out is obviously we're going to show videos now because there's things that I just can't describe with words. As part of this study, I had a variety of consents. One, of course, was not to participate at all. Another one was that you could submit videos that we could use in a forum like this, as well as you could submit videos that only our research team would look at. So anything here, with the exception of the last, which I'll explain why that one's different, everybody has consented to say, yes, this is okay. So here's one example, and you know, we're gonna call this kind of a dystonia with a tremor. So the key thing I'd point out, as we'll see if it plays, is if you look at the hand positioning, especially of the left hand, if you notice the way the hands are being held, you know, this is not overly disruptive, but I don't think anyone in this room, you know, has their hands held in that position at rest. And so dystonia is this kind of, you get combined activation of the flexor and extensor muscles, and it causes odd positioning. So when we had our movement disorders people looked at that, 10 of 10 said, yes, there's dystonia. Well, this young man also had another video, in which case 10 of 10 said he had myoclonus as well. So these things are not completely independent, and someone can have more than one. So here's another example, and really just we're looking just at the hands. And again, as you watch more, there's kind of some, you know, odd positioning, and almost what's in the left hand, the finger's kind of a swan neck. It's again it's like the competition between flexor and extensors, and so this would also be a dystonia with a tremor, and when we look at those kind of cartoon drawings, what we would say is this has more of a sawtooth morphology to it, so it kind of is tremor and rhythmic, but it's irregular, and so that's what's reflected in the left-sided picture. Where the right-sided picture is a more classic tremor that we would say is more kind of sinusoidal. So this example is actually from the Nashville Angelman walk. Mom was very excited. But so this is more of an example of a tremor where you watch, mom's strongly encouraging her to have another bite, and you see more of this sinusoidal kind of tremor. So, so it gets more complicated. And so if you wonder what the numbers are, this is when we're describing and having my movement disorders people say, hey, what is this? You know, 7 out of 10 said, well, there's some dystonia here. 6 out of 10 said, oh, there's a component of myoclonus. And 2 said, yeah, that kind of looks more tremor. Now, again, you'll notice those numbers add up to more than 10, And that's just the point that there can be more than one component. And so it makes it a little harder, but I think the key thing, again, if you notice that hand positioning, that's a dystonic posturing. So here's another young lady, and she's demonstrating more what we would describe now as myoclonus, which is, again, we can't replicate myoclonus. It's this rapid twitching. And so you can see there. There we go. Sorry, my screen here died. So it's this kind of irregular, kind of herky-jerk. You can see where it's kind of tremor-like, but again, it's more irregular. Now, unfortunately, you know, here's the additional challenge of she also had an event where it had some myoclonic movement, but then it evolved into a generalized tonic-clonic seizure or secondary generalization. So again, this is some of the challenges whenever we're trying to get histories of knowing exactly what we're talking about. And this is why I think for me, I tell families all the time, you know, everybody has a video camera on them at all times nowadays. You know, you may call it a phone, but nonetheless, you can make videos, and it's an extremely helpful tool for us. So now, this young lady, this is, again, more of an example of a myoclonus. And this, again, there's two different examples, but you can see there's kind of some, you know, it looks rhythmic, but it's irregular. And this young lady happens to be actually one of my kiddos. And notice her shirt. It's fragile, not like a flower, like a bomb. I love it. But she was one where we actually used a medicine to treat dystonia, and she responded very well, which is kind of a curveball for when I discuss this with the movement disorders people. They're kind of like, oh, we don't know why that was. But nonetheless, she's done very well. But, you know, part of the goal of this whole project, too, is to then have a repository, because I think this is important for families and clinicians alike, that we know what we're talking about, and when we throw these terms around, everybody is on the same page. And especially as we go forward with clinical trials, and more so when we get clinical trials in our older kids and young adults, that we make sure that this is something that's represented. Now, to throw in a curveball, again, and go in a completely different direction, if you ever wonder if physicians actually listen to what you say, I promise we do. This was something that came out of one of my patients had these weird spells where she would laugh and then it seemed like she lost consciousness. And so then, you know, when I sneak in and go to like read, you know, Shaking Angel's Facebook, you know, in the shadows, you find things like, oh, other people have reported this. And so now the question is, well, what is this? And the first thing is, as clinicians, you know, this, if I have one patient that's ever reported this, that doesn't mean other people don't have it. It's just I haven't seen them, or they maybe never thought to tell me about it. And so it's something that, you know, when Han and I have discussed as, is this something we need to have a question about in natural history just so we're thinking about it and talking about it? Because I think in a lot of cases, you know, when we talk about what are called gelastic events, that's the fancy word for laugh-related, there can be seizures, there can be syncope or passing out spells, there can also be cataplexy, which is a sleep disorder. And while some of these things, you know, I think a lot of our kids are not terribly excited about coming into the epilepsy monitoring unit for a couple of days. And surely being hooked up to an EEG in the hospital is not a place where people are likely to laugh as much as they might otherwise. So we need to think creatively about how we're going to figure these things out. Yeah, and here's an example. I think hopefully they'll turn the volume back on for this. So, this one's special. Mom and Dad specifically made this one for me. But, no, he didn't pass out. But you could see when he was laughing so hard, it was kind of like what we'd call a breath-holding spell in some of our younger children. So it wouldn't take much. If that went on a little bit longer, that could actually cause him to pass out. So he's never had a passing out spell, but he was just the best example of a very good laugher I could find. So the key is, if there's kind of funny spells you see, make sure your providers are aware, because these are all things that we want to figure out. And, you know, laughing is not a bad thing, unless in a super really rare case, it could be a bad thing. So I think the key things I take away from this is I promise we're thinking hard about these different movement disorders. I do think there's kind of two bigger groups, one that's kind of more myoclonic in nature and then more of a dystonic. In that, again, a lot of this to me, I think, is focused on the deeper brain structures called the basal ganglia. One of the goals that I want to work forward is not only work with our colleagues here, but rope in more of our adult providers to figure out how we can start to capture the older population so we can move forward with potential clinical trials. And of course, I have some ideas of things I'd like to try, but that's all something that we need to work on deciding. And then again, something like with the laughter spells, you know, if we can define some clear questions that Wenhan and his team can add to natural history, that's just more data. Because if we don't ask the question, we're never gonna get the answer and we'll never know. So just the key thank you here goes out to all of you. I feel like I get brought into people's homes whenever I get videos, and all of this information has been provided from families in both survey form, which I know everyone loves, and then sending me videos. So, and then that's the rest of the team. So thank you all.